What's going on, guys? This is Rob, and if you're enjoying the content here on my channel, then make sure you hit the like button and make sure you hit subscribe so you can help decide what direction the content on my channel goes in the foreseeable future. All right, guys, so we are officially in it now. I mean, we're starting Geoff Johns Green Lantern. The cool thing about Geoff Johns Green Lantern, though, is it's really just a fresh starting off point. I mean, we're going to start from the beginning. I mean, every Sunday will be Geoff Johns Green Lantern until we finish it. So we're going to be going on really all the way up until the start of DC Rebirth, to be quite frank, because DC Rebirth, Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps just picks up where Geoff Johns had largely left off. But, or I think actually it was probably Robert Venditti, I think, at the tail end of New 52. But regardless, the fact remains here, Geoff Johns Green Lantern is kind of an overarching term. Like, you'll see this a lot. If you search Reddit, you search Reading Order, something like that, people will say Geoff Johns Green Lantern. It's not really just Geoff Johns. I mean, Geoff Johns wrote the main Green Lantern title, but there's also Green Lantern Corps. And what this does is it tells the same story from two different sides. Green Lantern focuses on Hal Jordan. Green Lantern Corps focuses on everybody else. Now, we'll see, like, John Stewart, we'll see Guy Gardner cross over into, really into Hal Jordan stories, but on the whole, Green Lantern Corps will focus on, like, the lost lanterns, the ones that everybody believed were dead, you know, when Hal Jordan became Parallax and supposedly killed everyone, as well as Guy Gardner, Kyle Rayner to a degree, John Stewart, a lot of spacefaring adventures, different things like that. They'll come to a head when we get to, like, the crossover. So, Sinestro Corps War, Blackest Night, Brightest Day, Revenge of the Green Lanterns, different things like that. But for right now, this is really just kind of starting off with Geoff Johns Green Lantern. Now, the cool thing is, remember, this is really just kind of Hal Jordan after he came back after being Parallax. Now, a bit of a refresher here for those of you guys who are familiar with Green Lantern. Bear with me for a second, because I think we might be getting a lot of people who are kind of new to this. With DC trying to find a way to reinvigorate Hal Jordan or reinvigorate the Green Lantern mythos, they basically got rid of Hal Jordan and they replaced him with Kyle Rayner. Now, of course, this came out of the death of Superman, because the death of Superman was as good of a point as any as to basically to reboot the entire Green Lantern mythos or to reinvigorate him. So what DC did is they had Hal Jordan come back from space only to find out the cyborg Superman and a villain named Mongol had destroyed Coast City. And then in return, Hal Jordan more or less lost his mind. He used his ring for selfish reasons to basically recreate the city, that kind of a thing. And what it did is it set in motion the Guardians chastising him for it. Hal Jordan lost his mind. He went crazy. He killed virtually all the Green Lanterns. He killed all the Guardians of the universe except for Ganthet, who finally managed to make his way. People kept giving me a hard time about, like, putting an L in there. It doesn't really matter too much to me, but people were giving me a hard time about it. And I was like, whatever, I'll try to pronounce it as best I can. But the fact remains here that Hal Jordan basically became Parallax. He adopted the name of Parallax. Now, what Green Lantern Rebirth did is it came back and it said, no, Parallax was not a name that Hal Jordan adopted. Parallax is an actual entity. Now, how that influenced Hal Jordan's life, we'll actually find out over the course of this story. But the cool thing here is that this really kind of gives us a bit of a refresher, because you got to remember, you know, Green Lantern Rebirth was one thing, it's another to actually start a new volume. And the good thing about what Geoff Johns does is he gives us a lot of stuff, but he does it in a way that makes sense and is easily digestible, as well as treating every single story, every single beginning of a new story arc, as though somebody's picking it up for the very first time. And so again, it's easily accessible. It's just one of those things where, despite its ease of access, it's better when it's read as a whole. And so again, what this does is kind of jump back to the early days of Hal Jordan, basically being offered the Green Lantern ring by Abin Sur. Of course, we know that Hal Jordan accepts the offer, and again, it just kind of picks up with him as part of Ferris Air. Now, of course, Ferris Air has basically grown, you know, since the last video we did, where we talked about Hal Jordan's secret origin, where he was basically the last man standing, working alongside Carol Ferris to try to keep Ferris Air intact. But what this also does is it brings in a person by the name of Cowgirl. Now, again, the cool thing about this is that Hal Jordan really kind of reminds us that he never really uses his ring unless he absolutely has to. Instead, you know, he prefers to fly without his ring. It kind of, you know, keeps the thrill of exhilaration. It keeps things going in terms of him maintaining his interests. At the same time, there's basically a craft of sorts that's been detected by Hal Jordan that's currently, you know, orbiting the planet Earth. When they get there and they investigate it, they end up finding out that this craft, doesn't really seem to have any recognizable features, which is to say, it's not Earth-made. What this does is it coincides with the arrival of what appears to be a robot, actually a Manhunter. Now, of course, the Manhunter's appearance here just comes with eradicating virtually everybody that it comes across, but this Manhunter looks totally different from the ones we've seen before, because the Manhunters, as we we know them are usually cloaked in red. They have a very distinctive look in terms of how they appear. This seems to be a new generation. Now, at this point, we kind of jump into like the aftermath of what's going on with regards to how Jordans return. Keep in mind, Coast City had been totally obliterated. And the result is that Coast City has actually been dubbed Ghost City. And the reason why is because there's hardly anybody there. Not only that, again, we pick up with Hal Jordan's younger brother, Jim. Now, of course, we saw with regards to Secret Origin that Hal Jordan was trying to reconnect with his younger brother. He was trying to reconnect with him, trying to help him understand where he was coming from, everything that was going on. With the return of Hal Jordan following, you know, of course, his presumed death while he was Parallax, eventually becoming the Spectre, he's basically trying to reconnect with his younger brother. But what Jim says is that he's not coming back, that he has no intention of coming back to Coast City. Almost no one does. And that's the issue. A lot of money is being thrown behind the redevelopment of Coast City. A lot of money is being thrown behind basically restoring it to the way that it used to be. The problem is that everybody's terrified of living there because either they've lost friends and family when they were there and it's just too hard to go back, because people are afraid it'll be destroyed again, because people just don't see a reason to go there because there aren't very many thriving businesses. It's one of these circumstances where no one really seems to have a reason to be there except for those who have basically lived there their whole lives and just refuse to leave, or people who have moved in because property's cheap and different things like that. But again, in the middle of this conversation between Hal Jordan and his brother Jim, we're basically met with the introduction of Cowgirl. Now, Cowgirl is actually a pretty cool character. Remember, that's her call sign in the Air Force. I was never in the Air Force. I've only known a couple people who have, but as far as I'm aware, in the Air Force, I guess they have call signs. I'm not 100% sure about that, but in this instance, this girl's call sign is Cowgirl. Now, Cowgirl does not seem like she would be really important. It seems like she'd be a throwaway character. She'll actually be huge when we get to the Star Sapphire, and that'll be really, really awesome. But again, what we end up finding out here is that with this particular plane that she's flying, it's basically powered by what appears to be Manhunter technology. And this is when we learned that, you know, with this vessel that had basically crash landed on Earth, you know, with the actions of the U.S. government going in, investigating, so on and so forth, throughout the history of Hal Jordan being the Green Lantern, the government had basically stumbled upon Manhunter tech. And that's what they're doing. They're basically using it and they're adopting it to their own ends. They're basically trying to figure out a way to replicate Manhunter technology and use it continually. Now, again, at this point, we switch over to a guy named General Stone. Now, again, I know I'm throwing a lot at you guys, but this is really a lot of world building by Geoff Johns. That's really what he's doing here. The first couple trades, the first couple volumes, you know, with regards to, you know, like this particular story, Green Lantern No Fear, Green Lantern Corps Recharge, it's a refresher. It's basically just kind of throwing a lot of stuff at us really, really fast so that we can kind of build on it later on. Now, of course, again, this will all make sense as we go through. It'll all just kind of come together and it'll create a very, very tight-knit and cohesive story. So just bear with me on this little part, but General Stone is actually really important to the history of Hal Jordan. The reason why is because, again, General Stone is the reason why Hal Jordan was booted from the Air Force. Hal Jordan was basically trying to find a way to get out of the Air Force so he could go see his dying mother, because his dying mother's one request was that as long as Hal Jordan's in the Air Force, he cannot come see her. He punched General Stone, and of course, General Stone had him kicked out. Now, again, the cool thing about this is that with the two of them talking with one another, General Stone does not know that Hal Jordan is the Green Lantern. Instead, it's just, hey, Green Lantern, thanks for saving our pilot, thanks for saving our ship, that kind of thing. But it's basically a reintroduction of familiar faces. Now, General Stone's role will be bolstered, you know, as we go through the Green Lantern stories and so on and so forth. But again, you know, we really just kind of transition to this Manhunter as it's being carried by convoy, and basically seems to go awry, of course, with John Stewart, the Green Lantern, investigating everything that's going on. He's working in tandem with Hal Jordan. And of course, John Stewart's the one that's kind of doing a lot of the legwork. Now, the reason why this is the case, and this creates a little bit of contention, you know, among some fans of the Green Lantern mythos. The reason why is because, in truth, John Stewart is like the number two, Guy Gardner the number three, if you had to go through and rank them. In truth, there are fans out there who love John Stewart and don't like anybody else. There are fans who like Guy Gardner and they don't like anybody else. Kyle Rayner, Hal Jordan, it's all the same thing. But Hal Jordan was the first of the Green Lanterns on Earth. And so he really kind of holds a level of superiority among all the other Green Lanterns. The kicker to this, the difference here, is that John Stewart brings his own area of expertise. And that's really why it is that Hal Jordan is defecting to John Stewart here. Because John Stewart was an architect. John Stewart was in the military. John Stewart has a lot of experience dealing with different scenarios that have to, you know, that coincide with structural weaknesses, determining what it is that caused something to fail. If Hal Jordan showed up here, he could probably pull it off, but not as well as John Stewart. And that's the great thing about Geoff Johns' work here, is because Geoff Johns looks at each of the individual Green Lanterns, really each of the individual members of the entire Lantern mythos, and says, what are their strengths and weaknesses? We'll put them in situations where their strengths are highlighted. We'll take them out of situations where their weaknesses are highlighted, and we'll put somebody else in their place. And so what it does is create a really, really cool and rich method of storytelling, where we basically get a lot of the the characters at the height of their abilities. Now, of course, a lot of this will be turned upside down with Sinestro Corps War, especially given the limitations of the Green Lantern Ring versus the lack of limitations with the Sinestro Corps Ring. But the fact remains here that with Hal Jordan, you know, going back to visit his brother, you know, going back to speak with Jim after having previously taken off, Jim kind of reiterates his point that Jim, his wife, his kids, they're not coming back to Coast City. But for Hal Jordan, it's like, look, people are trying to build here. The only way anything is going to grow is if people start coming back. Somebody has to take that first step. And Jim's response is, then go find somebody else. And again, it's really kind of cool here because what it shows us is that instead of making this isolated, instead of treating things as though the destruction of Coast City happened, but nobody really cares about the impact, it tells us the impact lives on. The people are terrified of living there. Nobody wants to be the one who gets blown up on Coast City. Now, again, at this point, it really kind of transitions back over to Hal Jordan, continuing on his journey, you know, going through and investigating a lot of this information and so on and so forth with regards to, you know, the Manhunter and you know, that kind of information. But ultimately, with the Manhunter having been successfully transported to a military base with no one being aware that they're basically toting a Manhunter, Hal Jordan's ring kicks into play, you know, recognizes a Manhunter is currently in the vicinity. And the result is that, of course, he activates and the two of them kind of begin, you know, battling with one another, you know, going towards one another. Now, again, the cool thing is that with Geoff Johns writing this story, what he does is basically give the reader, you know, us as the reader, a refresher on who the Manhunters are. And he does this organically. He does it by way of, you know, when Hal Jordan asks his ring what the heck's going on, the ring goes through a quick explanation of the Manhunters, which we can go ahead and do that here. So with regards to people who are new to the whole mythos, the Manhunters were really, like, up until the most recent retcon with regards to the origin of Volthoom, the Manhunters are basically the predecessors to the Green Lanterns. So the reason why is because of the fact that the Guardians have basically given up their emotion. And the line of logic from the Guardians of the Universe was that individuals who have emotion, who were tied into their emotions, can be easily manipulated. They can succumb to wrath. They can succumb to happiness, to love, to anger, so on and so forth. What we need are people who will basically carry out their mission, no questions asked. The Manhunters were designed to be that way. The issue was that a programming glitch took place in the Manhunters where they started going on a violent crusade where they basically said the only way to keep the universe in order is to eliminate all life. People, you know, races, different organisms cannot succumb to anger if they don't exist. They can't go to war if there's nothing for them to go to war over because they're all dead. The problem with this is that, of course, the Lanterns were created in order to respond to the idea that the Manhunters were too extreme, and the Green Lanterns really just kind of grew and expanded ever since. But the Manhunters have cropped up from time to time, and this is one of those instances where the question is, okay, how did this Manhunter get here? Well, we're kind of left to believe this Manhunter got here at some point in the distant past, you know, at some point along the line, and it was just now discovered. And in fact, that's the case that's actually going to be made. The kicker is that in the middle of the conflict between Hal Jordan and this Manhunter, the newer version of the Manhunter that's cloaked in blue shows up. Now, of course, Hal Jordan looks at it as a person that, you know, as a being that looks human and thinks it is some kind of backup, whether it's a superpowered being that he's never seen before or something along those lines. But of course, this second Manhunter turns against Hal Jordan and attacks him. Well, then the question that Hal Jordan has is, where did this Manhunter come from? Because it looks brand new. It looks newly created. If the Manhunter is newly created, who's making it? Who's making these new generations of Manhunters? The other half of this being, because this new Manhunter basically looks at the more damaged version and says, you're older, you're archaic, you're not new like I am. And so that's where Geoff Johns really begins to kind of set the seeds, plant the seeds of what's going on. Now, a lot of this will be answered in Green Lantern Corps, but with regards to what's going on at the moment, this is an example of what Geoff Johns does, where he basically engineers a situation where questions are kind of being asked, where people are trying to figure out what's going on. At the same time, something else that we also learn here is that with this newest iteration of the Manhunters, they're not like previous versions. Instead, this newest version has the ability to absorb Green Lantern energy. And so what it does is it makes the Manhunters a lot more dangerous than they were before, because instead of a Green Lantern having to run up on a Manhunter and deal with their enhanced strength and so on and so forth, now the Manhunters will absorb green energy from Green Lanterns. And so again, it creates kind of a weird situation because Hal Jordan is trying to figure out what's going on, is trying to figure out where things are going. Now, of course, at this point, he goes and begins to kind of question General Stone. And it's kind of cool because General Stone is really stonewalling him here. I mean, not to do a play on words, but he's like, hey, look, man, a lot of this is confidential information. You know, it's top secret. We can't really tell you what we're doing. We can't tell you about this tech. We can't give you any of that stuff, you know? And in the end, you know, Hal Jordan's like, look, I need information. And he actually ends up punching General Stone. Now, of course, that's when General Stone basically figures out who Green Lantern is. He knows right off the bat that Green Lantern is Hal Jordan. Now, he doesn't tell him immediately, You know, he just kind of gives him a little bit of information here. Hal Jordan says, look, I need to borrow your jet. I've got to go chase after this Manhunter. Remember, Hal Jordan's ring has been drained of energy quite a bit. And so, you know, in the pursuit of this Manhunter, again, it leads to a pretty crazy chase. Of course, you've got General Stone on one side of the comms. You've got Green Lantern on the other. But it's really just kind of a back and forth here. I mean, it's really more of like an action segment, more so than any real, you know, genuine information to go on here. Now, of course, because of the fact that Hal Jordan can't really summon his lantern at the moment, he basically just uses the head of the Manhunter to basically re-energize his ring. But again, the question that he's asking here is, where did this Manhunter come from? Not only that, one of the Manhunters begins to basically experience or begins to show emotion. And that's why things are beginning to look funny to Hal Jordan, because Manhunters are inherently devoid of emotion. But where this Manhunter that he's basically taking out of the atmosphere and getting ready to you know, leave out in space due to the fact that its self-destruct mechanism has been activated in the final moments of its life, the Manhunter says it feels fear. Manhunters never feel emotion. And so the question Hal Jordan has is, how did we get to this place? Why is this Manhunter feeling emotion? This Manhunter should not feel any emotion of any kind whatsoever. And so what he does is, you know, Geoff Johns kind of gives us this little bit of a teaser where he basically kind of picks up with Hal Jordan and says, look, there is someone out there who is making these robots, making these new Manhunters. These new Manhunters are a little different. They're a little more capable. And so the idea is, what exactly are they going to be able to pull off? What exactly are they going to be able to do? Now, at this point, we really kind of jump to like this weird little story that Geoff Johns gives us, but it's basically him kind of leading into the prophecy of the Blackest Night, leading into the idea that we're basically going to come to a war of all the different Lantern Corps. Now, initially, this just kind of picks up with just some alien out in the desert somewhere. And it's actually hit, you know, by a vehicle. The alien simply says, you know, I just went out for a cigarette. But it's also kind of cool here because we get this little bit of a return to familiarity with Hal Jordan visiting the different members of the Green Lantern Corps. Now, of course, he and Kilowog kind of get into a bit of a beef. They get into a little bit of a battle with one another, but it's really a friendly one. It's not designed to be violent by any stretch of the imagination. But in the midst of this, Hal Jordan is contacted by Hector Hammond. And Hector Hammond says, they're back. Now, again, this is Geoff Johns changing things up a bit, adding these little tidbits of information that will go towards expanding the mythos. Now, with regards to this alien that was hit by a car and, you know, was basically taken by the US government, that what ends up happening is they basically start going through its body and realizing that this alien is basically human, but it's been aged by like 50,000 years or something silly like that. It's basically what humans will become at some point along the line due to their, you know, evolutionary process, evolutionary continuation. And so because of this, Hal Jordan goes to visit Hector Hammond, since Hector Hammond was the one that contacted him. Now, again, Hector Hammond's a really, really cool villain. He's one of those guys that I find to be really intriguing just because of the fact that Hector Hammond can't actually move anywhere. I mean, he's got a massive head and has to be kept on some measure of a support system in order to keep it from just kind of, you know, flopping over. But Hector Hammond is also a guy that, because he can't control his physical body, because he's strictly a telepathic and telekinetic being, that he can't enjoy the small luxuries of life. And that's the coolest thing about this, is that when Geoff Johns gives us this little bit of a story, it's basically him, you know, kind of showing us what life would be like without the ability to taste, without the ability to experience love, physical love, emotional love, different things like that. What Hector Hammond says is, I will tell you what's going on, but you have to let me have a memory. You have to let me have an experience. Some girl that you were with, some girl whose conversation you paid attention to, you know, let me experience that, you know, that fluttering of love, you know, those butterflies in your stomach, the hope that something great will come out of the night. You know, let me have that memory. Of course, Hal Jordan gives it to him for a slight second, but then Hector Hammond tries to overwhelm him. Now, again, this is cool because what it does is it shows us the experience that Hal Jordan has with Hector Hammond. Because Hector Hammond is a guy who doesn't have normal abilities, because he's not a normal person, he relies almost exclusively on telepathy, the impact of damage done to his mind is amplified that much more. And so what Hal Jordan does is basically reach into his brain, of course, using his lantern technology, and initiate, or at least kind of stimulate the pain sector of Hector Hammond's mind. And so literally, he's just kind of sending his body into an extreme form of pain. Now, of course, what Hector Hammond does is basically spill the beans and say that there are these beings that exist out there, these weird little aliens that don't do anything more than just kind of like mess with people. They kidnap stuff, you know, kidnap individuals. They just kind of experiment on them, see what all they can pull off. And of course, you know, what Hector says is, I'm not the only one. Now, again, this really kind of seems out in left field. It really kind of seems out in the middle of nowhere, but all of this is designed for the purpose of building up to something bigger. Again, we really just kind of switch over to Coast City, you know, to the water off the coast of Coast City, and we end up finding basically a shark that's been mutated. Now, this is not King Shark, all right? This is basically just a normal shark whose
physical design has been manipulated and been screwed up by these particular aliens and been jump-started into the future, you know, so that it's basically evolved at an extremely rapid rate. Now, again, at this point, all this really does is just show Hal Jordan facing off against the shark. There's really nothing of any major substance here. The only exception to this is when we switch over to Palmdale and Hillside Park, and we basically end up joining with William Hand. Now, remember, the last time we saw William Hand, he had lost his hand when the Spectre had taken it. And so because of this, what this does is it basically kind of gives us this idea that William Hand is kind of this avatar of death, in the sense that if William Hand goes through and touches things and drains the life energy out of things, then what it does is it begins to regrow his hand. Now, it's not like he could touch a tree and the whole thing comes back. It just sort of begins to grow back. And what William Hand begins to realize is that in order for him to regrow his entire hand, he's going to have to basically absorb the life force of people. So that's literally what he does. He starts traveling around and basically absorbing the life force out of doctors, out of nurses, out of patients that are currently dying, out of virtually every single person that he comes across, and reconstitutes his physical hand. Now, the reason why this matters is because of the fact that this is Geoff Johns sitting down and laying the groundwork for Black Hand being an avatar of Necron, the entity of the Black Lantern Corps. And so what this does is, as far as I can tell, is it takes the previous standing of Black Hand and it modifies it a bit. And what I mean by that is William Hand is a long-standing villain of the Green Lantern mythos. He originally appeared in 1964. The issue here is that back in the early days, he was just a goofy guy. He was just a goofy little villain. He would spat out these little cliche lines. There was nothing of any real substance to his character. Geoff Johns coming back with Secret Origin changed things up. You know, there was a point whereby William Hand had this device that would absorb Green Lantern energy. And so what Geoff Johns is doing is basically saying, look, William Hand is part of a much bigger picture. You know, where the Green Lanterns are avatars of the willpower entity in the emotional spectrum, Black Hand is the avatar of Necron, of the Black Lantern Corps, the same way that the Star Sapphires are avatars, the same way that the Indigos are avatars, and so on and so forth. Sinestro, you know, an avatar of Parallax, different things like that, that they basically draw off the energy of the emotional spectrum. Now, again, this basically picks up with Hal Jordan discovering who these aliens are, these aliens kind of experimenting on Hector Hammond. Hector Hammond basically saying they're the ones that made him the way he was, that instead of Hector Hammond simply just stumbling across the ship of Abin Sur and then turning around and activating this this meteor unintentionally, that instead the aliens had basically engineered this situation so that the U.S. military would find the ship of Abin Sur and then turn around and experiment on it, resulting in Hector Hammond becoming who he is. Again, we had talked about that in the Secret Origin of Hal Jordan. But at this point, we basically transition over to William Hand encountering Hal Jordan again. Now, this is where the tables have turned. This is where things are different. And even within the comic, Geoff Johns talks about this. You have Black Hand, who's basically taunting Hal Jordan, saying, there was a time where I was just a small-time guy. I was a small-time villain. Now I'm an actual serious foe. Now I'm an actual serious threat. More so than that, what Black Hand is basically saying is, Hal Jordan, you should be dead. You should not be alive. You were supposed to be dead. You were supposed to be gone. Somehow you have survived. It shouldn't be that way. And so again, it's really this idea of William Hand's entire obsession with the idea of death coming to bear. Now keep in mind, William Hand's not acting of his own volition. You know, his mind had more or less been kind of messed with, been tampered with. He's been influenced by Necron time and time again. This all really feeds off of Black Hand's obsession with the concept of death. Remember, you know, William Hand's family were basically coroners. They dealt with corpses day in and day out. William Hand's life is immersed in death. And that's exactly what he tells Hal Jordan. He says, your whole life is surrounded by death. The death of your father, the death of your mother, the death of the relationships between you and your brothers. Your life is nothing but death and destruction. You yourself have reaped death on a multitude of different people. Now, again, it's really kind of showing us the fact that there's somebody out there that holds such an absolute belief in the value of death. But again, Hal Jordan's response here is that he's not really afraid of death so much as he hates death. But even then, he basically says, without life, death is nothing. So again, this is Geoff Johns fleshing out the emotional spectrum. This is Geoff Johns basically telling us, on one end you have white, on one end you have black, you've got stuff in between, but the emotional spectrum spreads throughout all forms of existence. Life, death, willpower, love, all these different things are all part of the emotional spectrum. And so again, it's really cool because it's just kind of laying the early groundwork, planting the early seeds. We are by no means in the realm of seedlings right now. We basically just have seeds in the ground, we're nurturing them and trying to see what we can grow throw them into. And that's why Geoff Johns' writing is so good, is because instead of just simply saying, and now one day we have the Black Lanterns, instead, it's a slow build. It's a slow burn. And then it grows into this giant monstrosity of just incredible writing that just turns out to be something absolutely gorgeous. But again, what this story does is it basically kind of ends on the notion that Hector Hammond has essentially regained his ability to talk, you know, where he's no longer confined to just kind of being stuck in this this deteriorated body, that he's regained the ability to talk. Now, how far this will go is something we don't know. But again, these little, you know, aliens are basically handed over to the Green Lanterns, other members of the Green Lanterns, you know, for their own sectors, so they could basically, you know, be taken back and put on trial and that kind of thing. But again, this is really all just world building stuff. The story itself seems like it has nothing to do with anything, but it has everything to do with everything. It's going to be one of these where we'll actually reference this later on in future videos. So again, this is why I wanted to do it all, because, you know, I don't really want to leave anything to chance. I don't want to leave anything out. Even if the story seems totally irrelevant, seems totally unnecessary, we're going to cover it anyway. And the reason why is because, you know, with what Geoff Johns does, I really can't harp on this enough. What Geoff Johns does is he'll write Sinestro Corps, all right? He'll write Sinestro Corps War, and he'll reference one panel from this entire story. But it's important that we know what's going on, that we can all kind of have this well-rounded, huge, particular understanding of the whole thing. I don't know. I'm getting kind of carried away with this. I'm really excited. I'm really, really excited to do these stories. But if you guys are new here to Comics Explained, make sure you guys hit the sub button to become part of the Rob Corps. If you guys enjoy this video, make sure you drop a like, and yeah, I will catch you all later. Peace.